Hi, I'm Jeffrey, and right now we are going to look at the 12 apostles of Jesus Christ. Now, if you're familiar with the Bible, you know that it falls into two large sections. There's the Old Testament, and that looks at the relationship between the ancient nation of Israel and their God. And then there's the New Testament, which follows the life and ministry and teachings of Jesus Christ and some of his close followers who came after him. And those close followers, some of them, came from a particular group of people that spent a lot of time with him when he was on earth, and we call that group the 12 apostles. Now, the 12 apostles are listed out in three of the four gospels. The gospels are those first four books of the New Testament, and each one of them tells the story of Jesus' life, death, and then resurrection. Now, the first three give us lists of these 12 apostles. Jesus had many more than just 12 followers, but this group of 12 was specific. And then the Gospel of John doesn't give us a list of the 12, but it does give us some insight and a few episodes that involve members of the 12 that the other Gospels don't include. So we're going to put them all together and get a general idea of what the Bible says about all 12 members of this special group. Now, when you're reading the story of Jesus, there are two members of the 12 that get far more attention than anyone else. You already know them. They're Simon Peter and they're Judas Iscariot. Those are the two that get the most attention. And it's understandable why. Simon Peter was the de facto leader of the 12 and one of the key leaders in the Christian church after he believed Jesus came back from the dead and ascended into heaven. And then Judas, well, we all know why Judas would be important to the story. He's the one who betrayed Jesus to the Jewish leaders and the Romans of his time, and then ultimately Jesus was killed by them. So, let's take a look at these two, and then we're going to look at the rest. Simon Peter, very important. He is listed as first among the disciples in any list of the 12. And Matthew specifically says that Peter was first among the apostles. He recognized Jesus as the Messiah. You can read that story in Matthew 16. And Jesus tells Peter, you know, blessed are you, because flesh and blood didn't reveal this to you. Jesus believes that Peter received this as a revelation from God. And so that's pretty important. When we look at the character of Simon Peter, we see some duality. We see some ardent and fervent faith and loyalty to Jesus, as demonstrated by a time when Peter walks on water with Jesus, and when Peter is willing to fight violently on Jesus' behalf when Jesus is being arrested in the Garden of Gethsemane. But we also see moments of weakness for Peter that are coupled right with those moments of valor. We see Peter falling into the waves as he's walking on water with Jesus because he's afraid of the danger that he's in. We also see Peter turning around and denying that he knows Jesus, just a few pages away from when he was willing to fight for him. So this duality is something that we're going to see in the Apostle Peter as we're reading the story of Jesus. But that starts to wash away after Peter believes Jesus has come back from the dead. We have a chapter at the end of the Gospel of John in which Peter is reinstated by Jesus and tasked with caring for the other followers of Jesus. We also see him emerging as a leader in the early church. The Apostle Paul says in the Epistle to the Galatians that Peter is regarded as a pillar. And if you're reading the book of Acts, Peter is front and center in the first several chapters of the book of Acts. He's a very, very prominent leader in the early church. And according to church tradition, Peter has contributed a few books to our New Testament. First Peter has long been associated with the Apostle Simon Peter, and eventually Second Peter gained that status too. Enough people said, you know what, we believe this is genuinely from Peter, and it's a valuable book, and so that book has been associated with him for a very long time now in our New Testaments. the Gospel of Mark, while not believed to have been written by Peter, it is believed that that gospel was built on notes from Peter. Peter spent a lot of time with Jesus, therefore he would naturally be a good source for someone who wanted to tell Jesus' story. And that's what church tradition has taught for a very long time. It's not in the Bible, but it's been part of the story that Christians have told for ages. Judas Iscariot, on the other hand, not so well remembered. He betrayed Jesus. We know that he got 30 pieces of silver in return, but we're not really clear on what his end goal was. What we do know, and it could be that he just wanted the money. John says that Judas was stealing money from Jesus' funds. It could also be that he was trying to give Jesus a reason to fight Rome and free the Jews. We don't know. What we do know is that the other followers of Jesus, by the time the Gospel of John was written, believed that Judas was under the influence of Satan. It says that in the 13th chapter of the Gospel of John. Either way, Judas was not very proud of his actions. He ended up killing himself. You can read two different accounts of how that happened in the Gospel of Matthew and the Book of Acts. And he was ultimately replaced by a gentleman named Matthias. We don't know anything else about Matthias, except that he's the one who took position number 12 in this group. Now, let's look at some of the other members of this group. We have James and John. These are the two sons of Zebedee. And while we're reading the story of Jesus, while Jesus is alive, these two are essentially they show up in pairs. Anything that the Gospels say about James, they also say about John. It's not until we get about halfway through the book of Acts, when James is martyred by Herod, that we start seeing some different stuff about John. Now, there might be an exception to this, in that church tradition has said for a while, there has been a school of thought in church tradition that John was the disciple Jesus loved that we read about in the Gospel of John, and that John was the one who cared for Mary, Jesus' mother, after Jesus died. And that same line of thought is why we call the Gospel of John the Gospel of John, because a lot of people have believed for a long time that this man is the one who wrote the Gospel of John. He's been associated with the first, second, and third epistles of John and the book of Revelation. So there's a lot of thought that has gone into what sort of contributions John the son of Zebedee has given to the New Testament. And there are various camps when it comes to how much John actually did, but we couldn't do a video on the 12 apostles without mentioning that this character is associated with much of our New Testament and may have played a very important role in the life of Mary, Jesus' mother, and Jesus' family thereafter. Next up, we have Andrew. He's Peter's brother. He was, according to the Gospel of John, a disciple of John the Baptist. That's a different John, completely different John. You can read a little bit about John the Baptist in the first chapter of Luke. But Andrew, and also the first chapter of John, Andrew was a disciple of John the Baptist, and he's given credit in the Gospel of John for referring Peter, his brother, to Jesus. No small feat, Andrew. Way to go. Next we have Philip, and Philip is someone who recognizes Jesus as a significant prophet, someone that was prophesied about back in the Torah. That's the first five books of the Bible. And as soon as he meets Jesus, he starts introducing other people to Jesus as well. He also asks some good practical questions in the Gospel of John. Thomas is someone that you're probably familiar with. You've heard the term doubting Thomas. Well, that comes from this gentleman. Thomas was one of the apostles who, after all the other apostles were saying Jesus has risen from the dead, Thomas says, I'm not going to believe it until I see it for myself. And so then Jesus shows up and Thomas sees it for himself, and it ends just fine for Thomas. But Jesus says it would be really great if people believed this without seeing it, which is kind of a nod to those of us who are reading these works after Jesus has already left. Thomas is also called a twin. The word Thomas means twin, and you'll see in some translations, Thomas also called Didymus, which means twin. So it could be that he was a twin. Maybe he was just a Gemini. We don't know. Next up, we have Matthew. Matthew was a tax collector, which was not a popular profession among first century Jews. His job was to take money from his countrymen and give it to Caesar. Not something that a lot of Jews appreciated. But Jesus still called him to follow him, and he did. In fact, Matthew is credited with writing the Gospel of Matthew. That's where the Gospel of Matthew gets his name. We don't know much else about Matthew, but if he did write that Gospel, then we owe him a lot of thanks, including for being the first person to list out these 12 and give us some really good information on Peter. Next up, we have four names that we don't know much about. In fact, we barely know any more about these people than their names. There are some caveats down here, but we have Bartholomew, Thaddeus or Jude, and then James the son of Alphaeus and Simon the Zealot. We really don't know much about these people. Now, some people have speculated that these are names that were used for other folks. So maybe these names apply to other people. A lot of people have speculated that Bartholomew was just another name for the character Nathaniel, who shows up in John chapter 1, in which case we might know a little bit more about him, but there's not really hard evidence. There's not a real reason to actively believe that. Or at least I'm not convinced. And then we have Thaddeus Jude. We don't know anything about him unless this is the same Jude who was Jesus' brother and is credited with writing the book of Jude. If that's the case, then we know a little bit more about him. Not enough evidence for me to feel comfortable saying that's who this person is. And it's been up for debate for a very long time in church history. But if you're going to get to know the 12 apostles, you should at least know that these associations are made. That way you can have a good conversation about it and not be thrown off when someone brings it up. Let's get into some other questions and then we'll wrap up here. A big question you should be asking right about now is, why 12? Especially being that we don't know very much about the people. We have a third of them that don't have any lines of dialogue. They don't say anything. We don't know what they do. We don't know what they were like. So why 12? Why not just Peter, James, and John? Or why not just the people that we know something about? Well, it may be that the number 12 is more important than the 12 individuals themselves. 12 is a key number in the story of Israel, and therefore it's a key number in the story of the Bible. Because when we look at where the nation of Israel came from, 12 shows up over and over again. So Jacob, whose name was changed to Israel, he had 12 sons. This was the beginning of the nation of Israel. Moses led 12 tribes out of Egypt. It was a multitude of people that had still retained these tribal identities, according to the Torah. And then David, the king of Israel, united 12 tribal territories. And so we see this number 12 showing up over and over again in Israel's origin story. There's more that we could get into. There were 12 judges in the book of Judges. There is a group of books in the Old Testament that are called the 12. Christians call them the minor prophets, but in Judaism, they were called the 12. So 12 is super important. Next, a quick note on the inner circle. So you may have noticed Peter, James, and John I have in orange boxes up here. And that's because these three accompanied Jesus for some rather exclusive moments. We don't know why. It could have been a parallel to three of David's closest and most trusted warriors. We do see Jesus being presented as the new David in the gospel narrative, so it's possible that that's a parallel, but we don't really know why Peter, James, and John were selected to be so close, but they do regularly show up at times when none of the other 12 are there. And so that's an interesting dynamic that we see when it comes to the 12. One other thing that would be important for you to know is that while the synoptic gospels give most of their attention to Peter and Judas Iscariot, with a few mentions of James and John. Most of what we know about the rest of these characters comes from the Gospel of John. It's not found in the Synoptics, but he gives some speaking lines and some episodes to members of the Twelve that we don't normally get, or we don't see in the Synoptic Gospels. So those are some interesting things to keep in mind when you're studying the 12 apostles. This should give you a good overview, but if you want to know a lot more, check out our beginner's guides to the 12 apostles. We have write-ups on the individual ones, we have infographics on the individual apostles, and we have a comprehensive guide to all 12. You can find out how they died. You can find out who they were. What do we know about them? What's just conjecture? It's all on overviewbible.com, and I've added links to those in the description of this video, so you can check those out. Now, if you want to know more about how the whole story of the Bible fits together, why would Jesus want to come in and be presented as a new Moses? Why is being compared to Moses or David important? Then I suggest you check out my book. It's The Beginner's Guide to the Bible. And in that book, we look at where the Bible came from, what it's for, and what it's all about. And it'll give you a good understanding of how each piece of the Bible fits together, and you'll understand the big picture. Also, if you enjoyed this video, I suggest you subscribe to this YouTube channel. That way I can notify you just as soon as the next one goes live. Again, I'm Jeffrey with Overview Bible. Thanks for watching. I hope this was helpful.